Welcome to the third Wealthy Boomer interview with Hank Cunningham. Actually, he's the fixed income strategist for Odlum Brown, not the director of fixed income. And he's also the author of In Your Best Interest, second edition, which is a book on the Canadian bond market. Welcome back, Hank.
Thanks. Good to be here, John.
And I thought we'd talk about your book. Spends, even the first edition, spent a lot of time on bond transparency and pricing. You know, people who are in the equity culture are used to paying commissions and seeing what they're paying. Mm-hmm. They seem to think sometimes, naively, that there is no cost to bonds, but of course it's all hidden.
That's right. It's marked up. It's what they call a transfer price, where the salesman or investment advisor receives a price from his bond trading department of, say, 98, and he marks it up to 99. So that there's a dollar or half a dollar charge that the investor never sees. I've been on a committee that, well, I was one of the ones who pushed hard to reveal what bond commissions are. I don't see why we wouldn't reveal this. And if people saw what they were paying, they would realize that it's just as good a deal as they're getting on their equity commission. So there's nothing really to hide here.
Is it good a deal or is it bad a deal?
Just about the same. You know, the average is about a half a point, you know.
Okay, so let's give an example. You buy a bond for $10,000, mm-hmm. let's say. What's the commission normally on that?
Probably $100.
$100? Doesn't seem bad.
No, it doesn't. You know, it's 1%. And most advisors don't get paid unless they produce $100 of commission. So on a larger transaction, the commission would be a lot less in terms of percentage over what you pay. But the dollars, like a $50,000 transaction, it wouldn't be $500 commission, probably like $250. So as the size of the transaction goes up, usually the commission goes down. And it depends on the product. People charge, investment advisors charge more commission on corporate bonds and a higher percentage on strip bonds, even though the markup is the same in the dollar terms. It's because it's a low dollar price security.
Now, I've heard people criticize the financial industry, saying that there's the equity culture, the advisors are only paid really properly on the equity side, therefore they're not motivated to recommend fixed income, and therefore this crash, and we talked in the first segment about being underweight fixed income, was a direct result of the advisors' desire for compensation, but you're saying that they are getting compensated.
Well, they're definitely getting compensated, and new issue compensation is also very attractive in fixed income issues, but it's an educational matter, both for the advisor and for the investing public, which is why I wrote my book, to help people arm themselves with the ability to buy individual securities. It's too easy for them and too easy for the advisors to end up in a mutual fund because you just buy it and you know what you're paying.
And then the advisor gets an ongoing trader
fee,
which he doesn't get on direct income.
Yeah, the economics are very attractive for advisors to not do individual bonds. And so there's about 5% of the sales force in Canada that really is well equipped to deal in individual securities, even though it's in the best interest of the customers that they find these IAs who can deliver customized portfolios for them, because it's in their best interest to do that.
So how does one find out what these commissions are? You mentioned an online website or several.
Well, there's a website called canadianfixedincome.ca. It's a company that aggregates the bids and offerings from about 6 or 7 investment dealers and posts them for other investment dealers to buy and sell bonds from. Like smaller dealers without a bond desk can go to this company and buy and sell bonds. But they produced a public website that reveals what the bids and offerings are on a wide variety of bonds all day long. So it's real-time bond quotes.
It's free?
It's free. And therefore, you can compare a price on an actively traded bond. You can ask your advisor for a price on a bond and then compare it with what Canadian fixed income is. And you have a good idea whether you're being charged too much or not. What the investing public doesn't know is that every investment dealer is required to have their own internal commission grid available for OSFI to review if they come auditing. And you can ask for it, and the dealer would have to reveal it, but they don't make a point of posting it anywhere. You have to actually ask for it. But everybody's required to produce a grid on every security of every maturity, and I publish an example of it in the book.
But let's say you belong to one of the discount brokerages, one of the big banks, and when you go in and buy bonds there, are you seeing the commission grid there?
No, they don't reveal that either. It's the bond market operates on a net basis, so whatever you pay, the fees are built into that price. You don't see it. I do know from my own comparison, because I was able to do this independently, is that there's a wide variance between the discount dealers, and some of them are very fair in their pricing. TD and BMO in particular have very fair pricing. And the three others I don't really want to talk about. It's not good.
How about the E-Trades and some of the non-bank discount brokers?
Well, E-Trade, I guess, was bought by Scotia, and I think they were very competitive because they had good input for their inventories. They were very good at fixed income bonds, but now they're being swallowed up by Scotia. I don't think that that situation will exist any longer.
Now, your site, inyourbestinterest.ca, does that have any bond sort of transparency?
What I've done, I posted the highlights from the Canadian fixed income page. It's embedded in the front page of my website so that you can just glance at my website and without having to go to the other site and see what the bond prices are doing on a current basis. And it's updated all day long in real time.
Now, how about index? I mean, people talk about indexing the stock market. I mean, we talked in one of the segments about indexing fixed income. Does it make sense in the government market or only in the corporate market?
Well, indexing, the way you index is just to buy an ETF, because all an ETF does is track an index. You could buy the XBB, which tracks the entire Scotia Capital universe, or the TMX now universe of bonds, or you can buy the corporate one or the real return one. Or by my choice, though, and it's more cost effective and more competitive in terms of returns to put your own ladder together. And then you've got your own quasi-index, if you would, 10 securities spread over 10 years, and only paying one-tenth of the fees you'd pay for anything else. So it's a very effective way to manage your money, I think.
Let's talk for our last question about sort of asset allocation. Here we are somewhere, hopefully near the bottom of this horrendous stock market decline of 2009. People are thinking they should be rebalancing. Maybe they were protected in fixed income. Is it a good time to take some partial profits in fixed income and buy equities at the low, to Odlum Brown's equity side, or not? I mean, I want to get an idea, as the baby boomers retire and the demand for fixed income securities, what is the opportunity right now?
Well, the opportunity right now is in high quality corporate bonds. Government bonds are ridiculously expensive. So my preferred approach right now would be to sell government bonds and buy some really select group of high quality corporates and pick up the 3-4% that you can pick up. You can get 6% in a decent corporate bond right now, or 7%. And governments are less than, 5 years is under 2% now. So I would advocate not owning any federal government bonds. I'd advocate provincial bonds, though, because there are 125 over Canada's. So you can find good quality bargains out there. As to the asset allocation itself, it'll depend on where you are right now. If you're skewed too heavily in fixed income, this would be a good time, certainly, to be buying some high-quality stocks. But if your fixed income portion is too low for your long-term needs, then I think what you'd do is selectively purchase some high-quality corporates and pick up some good yield.
What's the dynamic of supply and demand for bond? I'm thinking, as the boomers become, now here they've experienced the shattering experience of the stock market. Books like yours are going to encourage people to go and have more and more fixed income, be more cautious, maybe have bonds equal your age. But as that demand drives, is there going to be a greater demand for bonds than the market supply? And what does that do to the price and the availability of these bonds?
That's a good point. Right now we're experiencing the bizarre time when the demand for 30-year bonds is unbelievably high because of the need for actuarial assumptions and pension funds to be met. And you need to have long-term assets to meet long-term liabilities. So there's huge demand for longer-term securities. So there'll be imbalances in the supply-demand depending on the maturity you're looking at. But I can tell you the bond supply always rises to meet the available demand, John. There's no shortage of bonds ever.
They could just create new products.
That's what they do. They keep printing it. And now we're entering a period of severe government deficits. So we're going to see a terrific increase in the quantity of government bonds outstanding, which again makes them not a place to put your money right now.
Well, thank you very much, Hank Cunningham, the author of In Your Best Interest, Edition 2, the Fixed Income Strategist for Odlum Brown, based in Vancouver.
Thank you, John, for having me.